Hello everyone, Stjepan here. I'll continue the series on Bobby Fischer with a remarkable game he played against Viktor Korchnoi in the 62 Interzonal tournament. And first of all, before I start, I'd like to apologize for the background noises. There's quite a big storm in my neighborhood, so I hope the sounds don't bother you too much. Anyway, the 62 Interzonal tournament was the event that would decide six players to qualify for the Curaçao Candidates Tournament, which was played also in 62, and this Candidates Tournament in 62 was to determine the challenger to Mikhail Botvinnik, who had just regained his title from Mikhail Tal, who only held it for 1 year, and six players from this Stockholm Interzonal would advance to fight to decide the challenger. And at the time, Viktor Korchnoi was 31 or 32 years old, so older than Fischer. Fischer had just turned 19, I think, but he might have been in his late 18. Viktor Korchnoi was a strong player already. He had just won his first USSR championship in 1960. Then he won it again in 62. He won one in 64 and in 67 and in 70. I'm sorry. So he was at his peak strength, I would say, and he was soon to reach his peak rating of 2690, which was huge for that time, and he was one of the strongest Soviet players. And in the Interzonal, Bobby Fischer actually finished first, and he had a remarkable score of 17.5 out of 22, which was, I think that's an impossible result for anybody else, and he was in clear for first place, of course. And Viktor Korchnoi came in fourth with 14 out of 22, so slightly worse. But both of them went on to continue to the Curaçao Candidates. And this was a very tricky game that Bobby Fischer played. Of course, he always played e4, and he would usually face the Roy Lopez from the Soviets. And this game he prepared something special. So we have e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6, bishop to b5, a6, bishop a4, knight f6, getting into the closed Roy Lopez. And now after castles, bishop to e7, rook to e1, these are all the most common standard moves. b5, bishop b3, castles c3, d6. This is one move before the starting position of the Roy Lopez, let's say the most common lines. And here white will play h3, and now black decides whether he is going for the Chigorin with knight to a5, whether he will play knight to b8, which is the Breyer variation. He could also go for some other lines, but basically this is what was played at the time. This is what's still played today. And Bobby Fischer went for a slightly uncommon opening. He played d4. And this is the Yates variation of the Roy Lopez, and after bishop to g4, which is the only logical move, this is now the Bogoljubow, which is a very tricky line for both sides, but usually it's considered slightly dubious for white compared to the most common closed lines. And the point of the move h3 in this line is simply to prevent the bishop from coming to g4, because bishop coming to g4 is pinning the f3 knight, which is defending the d4 square. And white's main idea in the Roy Lopez, especially in the closed lines, which is why he plays c3 in the first place, not only to be able to play bishop to c2, is to push the d4 break. And now, if white allows bishop to g4, then d4 is much harder to play. However, after d6, after c3, d6, Bobby Fischer gets to play d4 immediately, and this is the point of the variation. So now, after bishop to g4, d4 had already been played, and now white will most commonly have a plan of playing d5, closing down the lines. Now they play the most common moves, of course. First of all, d4 has to be reinforced, so bishop to e3, because black was threatening to take the knight, and then if queen takes, then e takes d, c takes d, knight takes d would win a pawn. But and if g takes f, then white would have a ruined pawn structure. So now the game continues with e takes d4, c takes d4, and here knight to a5 was played. After knight to a5, bishop to c2, once again the most common line. And here black can choose between two moves. The most common one is c5, immediately gaining as much space as possible on the queen side. And the variation, a very theoretical variation, continues h3, bishop h5, g4, bishop g6. Knight b to d2, knight e7, d5, these are the standard lines after c5. And you can see that black has a pawn majority on the queen side, a very solid center. White has a weak e4 pawn, but white has a kingside attack and much more active pieces, and the knight on a5 is still misplaced, and it's not that clear where it's going to reroute to, because of course the c6 square is for now taken. But after bishop to c2, Viktor Korchnoi doesn't play c5, he plays knight to c4, which is the second most common move. Now bishop to c1 is played, of course, saving the bishop pair. And now we have c5. And now b3, knight to a5, another move and far more commonly played move instead of knight to a5 is knight to b6, and now after knight b to d2, knight f to d7, h3, once again this is the standard variation, the most common variation, but after b3, Viktor plays knight to a5, and now this allows Bobby to play d5, which visually first of all prevents the knight from coming into c6 and gains a lot of space in the center. And now it's not that clear that e4 is such a weakness because it's defended twice and it will take several tempi to be attacked at all with rook to e8 or anything else. So Bobby Fischer now has a slight positional edge already. We have knight to d7, knight b to d2, bishop to f6, attacking the rook, rook to b1, and now c4 is played, advancing on the queen side, but that isn't really such a big problem. First, h3 is played, and now bishop to h5 could be played. In fact, that would be more active than taking the knight, but Viktor decides to give away his bishop pair, and he takes bishop f3, knight to f3, and c takes b, a takes b, of course, not giving back the bishop pair. And now, Bobby Fischer has an almost decisive advantage, believe it or not. You can see the engine evaluation on the bar, in the bar on the right side of the board, but don't take it as your only source of information. Of course, the position is about to get very complicated, and the engine evaluation isn't the only thing that will matter. Of course, giving away the bishop with bishop takes b3 would be unwise, and this way he gets to prevent the knight from coming into c5 as well. And c5 is the only weakness in white's camp if the pawn isn't on b3. So a takes b is the far more active move. Now we have queen to c7, bishop to e3, bishop to c3, attacking the rook, rook to e2, b4 is played, reinforcing the bishop, and now knight to d4, getting into the central squares. And now already it's quite obvious that black has a weak f5 square, black has a weak c6 square. If black tries to gain any counterplay on the king side, e6 is going to be terminally weak, so f5 is completely out of the question. And of course the bishop, however good it might look on the c3 square, it doesn't really have that many targets, and it should never give itself up for the knight, because the white bishop on this diagonal would be completely winning positionally. So Viktor Korchnoi decides to continue with rook f2 e8. Of course, logically, you can't play f5, you can't play f6, you have to attack the e4 pawn. Okay, that makes sense. Now knight to f5 is played, putting pressure on d6, centralizing the knight, and the f5 square is by far the most active square for the knight in any Spanish positions, and usually white will have a plan of going with the knight from b1 to d2 to f1 to g3 just to be able to attack the f5 square, and now Bobby achieved it naturally. Now we have knight to b7, bishop to d4, which is the first inaccuracy, even though the engine say it's inaccurate, I think it's a very active move, and I think getting rid of this bishop would be a wise plan for white, even though it's not that active, because getting either the queen or the bishop on this diagonal gives white immense attacking pressure. Now we have g6, chasing the knight away, and now we have knight h6 check. Of course the king has only one square, f8, because the bishop is attacking the rest of the dark squares. And now rook to c1 is played, and the engines say that this is giving away the entire advantage, even though I can't really see why. The engines wanted Bobby to play bishop to e3 in this position, which I don't like as a move at all. I don't understand why this should be a good move. This is the variation the engine gives. And okay, I can see that white is slightly more active, but this position I would have every day rather than that one. And of course this is creating a pin on the queen indirectly, so if bishop takes at any point there's a lot of tactical problems for Korchnoi, and I just like rook to c1. And Korchnoi immediately returns the favor. According to the engines, rook a to c8 is a mistake, but once again I think the move is fine. Bishop to d3 is played, queen to a5, rook e to c2, reinforcing the rooks, and now of course this bishop is pinned, there's a battery on the rook on c8, so now if the bishop ever moves, the rook is lost. We have knight to e5, attacking the light squared bishop, a bishop to f1, which is once again a mistake. He should have taken on e5, according to the engines, because black would be pretty much forced to take with the e6 pawn, with the d6 pawn, I'm sorry, which would create a passed pawn, and if he takes with the rook, then there's a lot more tactical possibilities. But bishop to f1 is okay still, and white is supposed to have a slight edge. Knight to c5, bishop c3, simply gaining a pawn, and knight to c5 wasn't a mistake because it's attacking e4, but that's not that easily exploited. We have bishop c3, bc3, rook c3. Now, of course, if knight takes e4, then rook takes c8, winning a rook, so it doesn't work. King to g7 attacking the knight, knight to g4, knight takes g4, and now Bobby took with the queen. Apparently, it was much better to take with the h-pawn. I would prefer to take with the queen, in fact. And now, after h takes g4, rook takes c4 would be possible, and this would lead to a much more complicated position, even though the engines think that white is completely winning. But after queen takes g4, of course, taking with the knight, taking the e4 pawn with the knight is impossible because the rook is pinned, and taking with the rook is impossible as well because queen takes c8. So I think this move is perfectly fine and even better than h takes. So now Korchnoi reacts with rook to b8, attacking the b3 pawn. We have rook to f3, ignoring that. Knight takes e4, queen to f4, now double attacking the f7 pawn. f5, rook to e3. Rook to e5, rook to c6, and in this position, in fact, Viktor Korchnoi is supposed to have equalized. But he now makes a decisive blunder, and this is a move which... What he should have done is that he should have taken the d5 pawn and not getting into too many complications. Of course, he would be equal on material, and he would stand better. In fact, he would be a pawn up in this position, and he would have a passed central d-pawn, and I can understand why he would stand slightly better. However, his move is incredibly, incredibly bad. He plays rook b to e8, and now this simply allows rook takes d5. And of course, if knight takes d5, I can show you that. If knight takes, d6, then rook takes e5 would win the exchange, so it doesn't work. So after, in this position, after rook b to e8, rook takes d6, he played queen to a1, pinning the bishop, but this now allows Bobby to win the second pawn with rook takes a6. Of course, the bishop is defending the rook, and now we have queen to d4, rook to d3, attacking the queen. Once again, the bishop is defending, queen to b2, this is now completely busted, d6, pushing his passed pawn, g5, gaining a tempo on the queen, but after queen to e3, that doesn't really do anything. If the rook moves... If the rook ever moves, then the queens could get exchanged with queen to d4 check, and of course two pawns up is more than enough to win, and if the knight moves, then queen to d4 anyway, pinning the rook. So now Korchnoi reacts with f4, we have queen to a7 check, and here he resigned, and this is the last position in the game in which he resigned. And I have to say that even though Bobby let his advantage slip and he let Korchnoi equalize at some point, I think his play was very risky, and the risk was very justified. He managed to play incredibly active moves, despite giving up his advantage involuntarily, of course. The moves were too hard for Korchnoi to calculate, so each time Bobby gave him a chance to equalize and to gain an advantage, Korchnoi failed to do that, and he was... the position was too complicated to calculate. So now just let me show you what would have happened if Korchnoi continued playing. Of course, one of the only moves is king to f8, but now d7. And in fact, the best move, the only way to stay in the game would be to give up the knight with queen takes f2. And after queen takes f2, knight takes f2, king takes f2, rook to d8. This would be a position which Korchnoi could hold for another 5 to 10 moves, but that's it. But the position was clearly completely lost after queen to a7. I think this was a very nice game by Bobby Fischer. It was a remarkable attacking game, and he went for the Bogoljubow variation, which is fairly uncommon on top level, and it was even back then. Even though it was theoretical, it was much more common to enter the closed Royal Pass normal lines with h3, and I think this must have surprised Korchnoi. I hope you like the game, and stay tuned for more games from the Stockholm Interzonal, and after that we are going to continue the series on Bobby Fischer with the Curaçao candidates and see what happened there. Thanks very much for watching, and stay tuned for more chess. Bye!